said good day, sir!
Welcome back, everybody, to The Defense. It is our second series of the night. Thankfully, we are finally underway. The team's had a little bit of internet issues, but hopefully everything should be fine. Hoping, Durka. I'm Capitalist. I'm going to be joined by Durka. We'll see what happens, guys. We'll see what happens.
Fingers crossed. Toes crossed.
Yeah.
Everything, you know, touch wood, laminate, plastic.
Knock on wood, whatever you could do,
whatever
guys,
this is.
Whatever you could do, just don't. Don't let it be like that. All right. We got our first pick about to come up, so let's jump into the draft. Shall we? Team Alternate Attacks versus Danish Bears.
At least Danish Bears have done their homework. Banning out Wisp in first phase is, like, vital against Alternate.
Yeah.
I always see them as, like, kind of like Vega Squadron back in their infancy. You know, the Wisp Tiny was integral to them really coming to the forefront, especially with CIS Dota. Alternate, same kind of story. They do like to fall back on that combo. But they're not bad with others, you know. We've seen them have a lot of success with things like Ember Spirit back in the previous patch. But a new patch, first time I'm seeing them. Danish Bears, we've actually been relatively surprised at how well they've performed over the last week and a half, 2 weeks. And they definitely seem to have a pretty good grasp on Windows 10 making noises. There we go.
Just ignore me. Ignore that. That never happened. You saw nothing. Anyway, Shadow Fiend first pick for Team Alternate Attacks. I am just looking forward to Danish Bears. I don't know. I really like watching this team. They're super aggressive and they're good at it too. 5 seconds remaining. Like I would tell, like, it's funny because normally I would be on the side of Team Alternate Reserve Attacks, time. Like in a cast that Blitz and I had. We casted Team Alternate Attacks. In fact, who did they beat? They beat somebody, and I told them before. I was like, you know, this team is actually really good. They've been around for a while. You've Winter probably run into Wyvern. Some of these people in your pubs. And they're good. They're the only Polish team out there, but they're actually pretty good. They went 1-1 against New Team.
Okay.
So New Team's dropping a lot of games against teams that they aren't expected to. I would say I would place New Team as a solid like third or second place in their group, but they keep dropping games to who else did they drop a game to? Team pick.
Have they won a series? I'm pretty sure they've dropped games to, like, everybody.
Let's see. I'll pull up New Team here. Cuz they dropped a game against Danish Bears. No, they lost their series back. Against Danish Bears. They lost their series against Fum Fumes. They tied with ATN. They won their series against Lemon Dogs. Yeah, if they don't win their series Radiant against Lemon Dogs, they'd be in a really bad position. And they 2-0'd Power Rangers as well.
Okay.
But that wasn't actually for sorry, that wasn't for the defense. So. Dire team ban. All right, a little bit more to work with now. Winter Wyvern and Clockwork for Danish Bears. Dazzle being picked up by Team Alternate Attacks. So already physical damage and minus armor is going to be the combo for Team Alternate. Danish Bears, though, do have a lot of control and initiation between those first two pickups. I really love the Winter Wyvern. I feel like he's a support that warrants that first 1-2 pickup because there are very few situations where I feel bad about Winter Wyvern support. I feel this support has very few weaknesses. Ensuring kills is not his forte. So if you want some early kill power, that's not going to happen on the Winter Wyvern, but I feel like that's really his only downside as a support. Otherwise, he offers a lot. Going into the mid game, obviously, his control is really good with Winter's Curse. You have Splinter Blast, which allows him to be one of the few supports that is both viable and is good at defending towers.
Yeah.
You know, like, you look at, like, Keeper of the Light would be another support that's good at defending towers, but he's not nearly as viable as Winter Wyvern is.
Yeah, when you compare him to a lot of other supports, he's very good in the first, like, 5 minutes. Very early game, incredibly strong with Arctic Burn. Falls off a bit, you know, during the sort of middle part of the game or the period just after laning phase when, like you're saying, securing kills, finding pickoffs, getting that initial lockdown, Winter Wyvern definitely lacks. But Clockwork with the hookshot, great opener there. The one thing, though, that I've seen a lot from Danish Bears is the sister combo, Crystal Maiden and Lina. They love playing that combo. The Arcane Aura with then Lina in like a four roll running around with the Laguna Blade killing people. Hmm. They've loved playing that, but not this time around. They also really enjoy the Queen of Pain mid still for Hester Joe. So it'll be interesting actually to see what he goes for this time around, because there's no TA, no Quap, no Shadow Fiend, you know, three of really his strongest heroes. What's left in the pool for him?
Maybe we'll see something a little bit different. I was going to say maybe they'll pick up something like a Viper to really challenge that SF, but I think that's a little bit too much early game.
Oh, he has played some Magnus, actually. 10 seconds. He's played one game of Magnus, the rest of the heroes, but yeah, Leshrac, Shadow Fiend, TA, Queen of Pain, all the regular old ones.
What about Alina mid here? Because you still are Radiant side, so you'd still like something that would take advantage of stacks, I think.
Yeah, it could work. You may be limiting yourself with Alina, because she likes to go looking for those kills at level 6. And with the Dazzle out there, Grave is always that kind of backup plan for alternate. But he can't be everywhere.
I think drafting-wise, it would be really powerful, just because the Lina could still be run in a 4 position. I mean, it pairs pretty well with Clockwork and the Winter Wyvern, it's not bad with. But instead, they go for a Wind Ranger as their mid instead. I think we watched Hester Joe play this the other night. Pretty impressive.
There's been a ton of Wind Ranger recently. Mm-hmm. We saw KP, Cancel over on KP, the new player they've picked up. He played a sick Wind Ranger. He went like 22-2 or something like that, just diving into the middle of 5 of people and getting these shackles off. It's a relatively skillful hero with the Shackle Shot out there and knowing your limits with, you know, power shot damage, distance, the damage lost when passing through creeps and trees and things like that. So sometimes you do have to pull out all the stops to get the kills, but Shadow Fiend pretty squishy early on, so you can harass zone. And if you have the Winter Wyvern mid with the Arctic Burn, you can get such a great start with the Wind Ranger as well. And I'm looking at this now, alternate attacks, they pick up Dazzle and Bane. Both heroes can be used defensively, but also Bane can be thrown towards the middle lane. With Enfeeble or Nightmare, just the straight up Brain Sap, trading hits with the Wind Ranger or the Wyvern, you can actually hold your own and get Shadow Fiend the souls that he craves.
Yeah, that's the funny thing, right? Whenever you pick up an SF, you kind of need that support lane with you in the very beginning. And that's something you have to actually consider in the draft. I think otherwise, like an SF who doesn't get that kind of guaranteed first couple of CS, he could just so easily fall behind in those first like 3 minutes.
Yeah, it's kind of weird now we look at drafts this way. Because before it was always, we're looking for safe lane, we're looking for like a jungle support, a roaming support, off lane, and a mid. Now, I'd say 80% of games, we're constantly looking for that hero that goes mid for the first 2 minutes, the support hero that kind of zones and sits mid.
Yeah.
And we used to see it from, you know, EG with the Naga Skarath, whatever it was, to go and sit with Universe's Darkseer or Clockwork.
A lot more pressure being put on the offlaners as well. Seems like just the more pressure that you're able to put on during the laning phase, the better for your supports. Because whether it's like shutting down mid or shutting down the offlane, they just stay in lane. They don't pull that much. They don't farm as much as they used to. They don't go for super aggressive like ganks. It's not like the early smoke style necessarily. A lot more of it's just like passive laning presence. Anyway, what was the second set of bans? Templar Assassin and Ancient Apparition by Team Alternate Attacks. We had the Earthshaker and Broodmother banned away by Danish Bears. Now just waiting on the fourth pickup of Team Alternate. They only have so many seconds left until they're forced into a decision. Presume go for their offlaner at this point, and it's going to be a Nightstalker offlane.
Radiant.
Maybe we'll even see some sort of dueling, because I'm a little bit hesitant about a Nightstalker actually being able to fare all right in this matchup. If they have a strong, like...
I mean, even the Visage on his own can zone with Grave Chill.
Yeah. Then you throw something like a Gyrocopter or something like that that has laning presence of his own.
I'm still wondering about the Ancient Apparition ban. Like, sure enough, he's good against Dazzle, but I don't feel that's meaningful enough to warrant a ban on the AA. Mm. And Huskar hasn't been banned here by Danish Bears. I don't know if Huskar would fit here for alternate attacks, because Windranger's pretty good against him. The Wyvern also equally. Not too bad.
What do you think about a Spectre here for Danish Bears? because they have this like relatively early-ish lineup remaining. With the Clockwork. I would say Windranger has some early game presence, though she's remaining. Definitely a bit more farm-oriented than she used to be. The Winter Wyvern and Visage are maybe not the most early game Radiant supports, but they are relatively mid-game. If you are able to play this decently aggressively, the biggest downside for me is the Visage. If you had a more aggressive support, you could play off of a Spectre. And because I feel like the Spectre is pretty good versus, I feel it's a very good matchup against SF a lot of the times. These supports, like the saving support with the Shallow Grave, you know, that's actually very hard to keep those heroes from dying still with a Spectre remaining. On the field.
And then you force like the Grave onto yourself. If you jump onto the Dazzle, he has to Grave himself, and then you miss out on the Shadow Fiend.
Drow Ranger.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Drow Visage.
They're going to double down on some aggro here with the Drow Visage combination. Wind Ranger as well is going to hugely benefit from that Drow Ranger aura. Pretty interesting stuff. So Danish Bears now in the position where they're going to be the ones playing a lot more offensively. If they'd gone the opposite direction with the Spectre pickup, they would have been, you know, still trying to look for kills and everything else, but they would have been banking on the late game. Team Alternate Attacks now have the opportunity to go for better late game here, depending on their carry.
5 seconds.
A Drone Ranger, you want something that is able to get up in the face, and I almost feel like a really aggressive hero, like they actually banned away the Slardar. I would have loved to seen a Slardar for Team Alternate Attacks or like a Wraith King. You know, one of those early Blink Dagger heroes that gets in the face of the Drow Ranger and the Wind Ranger, puts pressure on them, but still has the tankiness to be able to survive that kind of initiation. Because if you survive through the initial part, you'll have the backup remaining. Of the Dazzle as well as the Bane. And then the SF obviously five comes in as remaining. Your dedicated right-click
Chaos
hero.
Knight.
Chaos Knight! I mean, that's another hero that goes right down the same line of thought. It's just, who goes Chaos Knight? Team Alternate Attacks go Chaos Knight, that's who.
I saw some people talking about Chaos Knights before this series. I don't know who was playing it, but I know it's been picked up a couple of times recently, even without a Wisp. Like, people have been tinkering with this hero. Now you get that minus armor debuff along with the crit. He can jump on the Drow Ranger as well, which I think is one of the biggest reasons you picked it up. I was looking at a Huskar here for them, and I was liking it as the draft progressed. The only big downside for me really was like the Wind Ranger focus fire, maybe the Visage Birds, but you know, you can work around that with Dazzle Grave, and then you've got Nightmare and Fiend's Grip out from the Bane. But then I started thinking about Spectre for alternate attacks. Like, that's also not too bad against the Drow Ranger. But like you said, they've got a relatively aggressive early game lineup that can go and apply pressure, that can hook shot, they've got loads of stuns, and they've got decent sustain with the Cold Embrace. So with a Chaos Knight, what do you even build on this hero? Without the Wisp, do you just go full stats and go like treads drums into S and Y?
No, I think you got Armlet still.
Still Armlet?
Maybe. I think the stats out of Armlet is maybe too good to give up. I don't think there's enough mobility on the side of DB that you really need the extra movement speed, right? Like, the Wind Ranger obviously has Wind Run, but the bigger concern is the Drow Ranger, and she's really not a very mobile hero. So I think you would still be able to just, you know, use that W to get onto him, and then that's kind of good enough, and then you just focus on damage from there. But
I know for the past year or so, some Danish players, Crit and Rise, have been talking about Chaos Knight and talking about Battle Fury Chaos Knight.
Battle Fury Chaos Knight.
Because he needs mana regen. HP regen's good. The damage is great with the crits, and you know, you can build yourself up and farm nicely with him. It's always been an issue of where do you fit a Battle Fury Chaos Knight into your draft.
Right.
But now you can pick up like a one-roll Chaos Knight, not need the Wisp, and kind of play him, you know, as an actual one-roll, rather than the roaming, ganking, killing kind of thing at 15 minutes, jumping around looking for all the destruction he can find. You could maybe find room for it, but I still feel like going straight into the stats is going to be the way to go. I guess Armlet wouldn't be too bad here. I've never been a big fan of Armlet on Chaos Knight. Like, things like Manta Style, the old school like Diffusal Manta build, I've always loved. But he's going to need a BKB pretty quickly this game.
All right, the push out here. The Bounty Rune is going to be split. Sasu as the offlane Night Stalker. I hate that taunt. It's so obnoxious. Kill yourself, SF.
It does not line up with the game's aesthetics.
No, it does not.
I am in disagreement with the usage of this taunt. So Ryze gets a lane ward down, but it's scouted out by the offlaner. But this ward here doesn't block up the pull camp. So Nightstalker sees what's going on, but he can't really stop what's happening. And the Gravechill, like I said, from Visage, should have a good time actually zoning this guy out. And mid is the 2v2 lane. Yep, there we go. But it's not the Bane, it's the Dazzle.
I guess I'm valuing the range of that a little bit more, plus the heal to keep Exotic Deer through the harassment of the Winter Wyvern. Keep him healthy. So I could kind of see the reasoning behind that.
And I guess it's more valuable having the Nightmare set up at top and then have the Dazzle stack and pull.
Oh, yeah. Even though he didn't actually go for Nightmare. It's a little bit surprising to me. Just because the positioning against a Clockwork is so key. But he probably figures he's going to get level 2 before they really want to commit to a kill.
And the mana cost reduction on Bane, Brain Sap. It's been such a great buff to Bane.
Oh, yeah, that's true. I forgot about that, actually. Oh, they get the call, but they don't have enough for... Well, actually, he does. If he wanted to pop the Mango, he could have thrown out the Chaos Bolt. But they just get the damage in.
Nightstalker, can you reach level 2 this game?
It's going to be tough. Ryze is challenging him quite a bit with that Grave Chill. The one downside is that Visage has such low armor that he can't really afford to get in range. Middle lane, we're going to have our first blood here. Hester Joe's going to run down Nisha. Tries to hide himself in the trees, but that's not going to work out for you. Windrunner
gets there first. Shadowfiend with level 1 raises is actually stuck here as well.
Yeah.
With Windrunner level 2 power shot, he's... Oh, is he going to die? No Arctic Burn. They'll try for the hits.
Oh, they even missed the power shot there. That's a little awkward.
Clock at top.
Yeah, he's dead. Maybe. Yeah, he's definitely dead. Right click does so much.
Thud. Chaos Knight with the biggest disparity between his right click attacks. 55 to 85.
Yeah, that was, I actually took a quick glance at Reality Rift earlier when he Reality Rifted the Clockwork at first, and I was like, oh my god, that did so much damage. And I was like, did they buff Reality Rift at all? And I looked at the damage, I was like, plus 60. I was like, no, it's just got to be that. He must have gotten a maximum damage hit plus the 60, because that looked like a 200 damage nuke. Sasu's dead at the bottom lane. Ryze finishes him up with a nuke, and this is not a safe lane for any melee hero, let alone a Night Stalker.
Yeah, Ace is just falling freely down here. Nothing really stopping him. And this is one of the issues that we were talking about previously, right? With the Nightstalker 4 roll roaming around, you can still find room to actually get the job done and then build into things like the Aghanims a little bit later on. But offlane Nightstalker, you need to have so much more impact. The Chocolate should be dead here.
Yeah. Battery Salt slows it down, but Hero Supreme still picks up the kill. Continuing to put a lot of pressure on this SF boy. He's only 7-4 in CS. 12-5 on Hester Joe, so he actually hasn't gotten that much CS either, but that's because they're playing so aggressively into the SF. They gotta be careful with that though, because Windranger doesn't have nearly the same kind of farming capacity that an SF does when you start getting level 5 and 7.
Yeah, she definitely needs to be wary of where this is heading. But if they can keep forcing Shadowfiend to, you know, ferry the bottle back and forth, and maybe even contest that that stack up for them. Yeah, Winter Wyvern, once he gets level 2 and 3 in Splinter Blast, they get the level 3 or 4 power shot, you could go and take stacks pretty quickly, actually. So it's going to be that timing hit. Also, not just stealing, but also killing off the Shadowfiend while he's taking it. So a good, quick Observer Ward down into their jungle. It'd be pretty big here for the Radiant.
I was just about to ask. I was like, does the SF use this Hatred and gank bottom? I was like, no, it's an SF. He's only level 4. Like that, I just highly doubt that's going to happen. But they're going to go for it. They're going to try and run down Ace here. They will be able to lead with the Void
Knight.
Pushback Silence. That's going to help out quite a bit.
He's still
but
dead.
Ace is still dead. The question is, are they? Yeah, they're going to go for more here. Ryze is actually going to go down as well as Sasu and Exotic Deer. Just chase into the trees to get that one. No TP response whatsoever from Danish Bears. And Sasu will TP himself out. So in the end, that is definitely worth it then for exotic tier. I was going to ask, like, if they only got the kill in the draw ranger, you'd kind of question whether or not it's worth it for the SF specifically. But with two kills, it makes it a lot better.
Yeah, he goes up like a level and a half. He's now got level 3 razors, boots, magic wand. He's looking pretty good for himself. And who's coming in from the top? Bane. Bane and Dazzle. They saw the vision coming out from the Radiant, so a quick little D ward. Chaos Knight's diving up at top.
Calm down there, Chaos Knight. They've got 4 heroes in mid right now. So I can't believe he was playing that aggressively when he has no backup in the top lane. I guess he thinks Draw Ranger and Visage, there's just no way they TP out of their lane. So in that case, the only turnaround, like the only hero that could be there would be Noya's Winter Wyvern.
Now Ace very early on against the Nightstalker, you know, he does well with the Draw Ranger, Frost Arrows, the Rise Grave Chill. But as the game progresses and Nightstalker gets his levels down here, Sasu can actually do a ton up against the Drow. You know, run her down and make sure that she can't get the damage out. But in situations like this,
man,
where they can just right-click him, force the TP away.
He really thought, I think he thought he was going to be fine, like he wouldn't be forced into that TP, but Draw Ranger has 3 levels of Frost Arrows. So even Nightstalker's early movement speed with that Hunter in the Night doesn't allow him to get away from the Draw Ranger like that. Dire Courier does go down.
Where?
That's an odd one. Ooh, the Clockwork got it. What? It's pretty weird.
I have a feeling Creeps killed him.
I think so too, actually. But I was just like, that'd be even almost weirder in a way. One Dark Troll Summoner, a stun, 3 second. Hero Supreme doesn't actually, he does have enough to be able to go for another Reality Rift, so Chocolate's got to be careful, really challenging this one. Reality Rift goes in, and 2 right clicks, and he gets the kill. Chocolate just really underestimating the power of the Chaos Knight.
Chaos Knight. Treads Bracer. This guy with 1,300 HP is very close to unkillable. And it's only 7 minutes into the game. Bot, Sasu, in a ton of trouble.
So much slow, and there's no TPs. I mean, both teams are playing so aggressively, yet neither team is actually responding with those kind of defensive TPs at all.
Yeah, even with relatively good reactive heroes, like the Dazzle, the Winter Wyvern.
I mean, Chaos Knight wouldn't be bad if he had mana.
Exactly.
That's always the problem on a Chaos Knight.
He's spamming his spells as much as he can on the Clockwork at top. He's actually hit level 8. Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Now, how useful is this Chaos Strike going to be? 5 armor reduction, 10% chance to on hit to get that.
I feel like it was a pretty solid buff. I think there's very few situations. Like, it's really late game when you have heavy amounts of damage and the enemy has high amounts of armor that the percentage change and the introduction of the minus armor element makes it worse.
Yeah, then they got Weave and Presence of the Dark Lord as well. There's so much minus armor coming out of this team.
Yeah, there's really a lot of potential.
Reality Rift on Ace. I got him. Stunned up for 3 seconds again.
There's the Roman Knight, or the Roman Chaos Knight. Remember when there was that 4-position Chaos Knight that was becoming a thing?
With a bottle rush?
Yeah.
Yeah. Silence. That was invented on Garena.
Whoa, Chocolate actually jumps through, managed to get the hookshot stun onto Sasu as well, but they're going to go for Supreme
here. Oh, the dodge.
They really need to get him. They will be able to slow him down. That illusion actually kind of spells his death with a Splinter Blast, but Exotic Deer comes in trying to challenge these four, knowing that they don't want to fight. Chocolate does have a Cogs, but the Courier's going to go down. Chocolate just locks him out with a Cogs. At least Sash managed to get a really good long-range Fiend Script, which might spell the end of our Clockwork. Whoa, the Ray is completely missing there. Did a short raise, and then only the medium or the long-range one came out.
Yeah, if he went for medium, I think medium was still on cooldown, so
yeah,
a little bit messed up there. Nightmare, they're continuing, they just never want to stop. Noya, double raise dead.
So they finally do get a kill out of that. I was expecting them to back out. Ace was pushing it in the middle lane in the meantime. He's going to be challenged by Hero Supreme.
The drums, the movement speed, the Chaos Knight, the reality rift, the fog. God.
Silence now. Okay, Supreme's just too tanky. You can't challenge him like that. There's no way. Ace just get some pot shots on him and that's it.
And that's the thing, like, how do you stop this Chaos Knight now? Because he's going to be running around doing this constantly. Stun during the wind run, 4 seconds of the hook shot off the mark.
And now he needs to throw a defensive set of cogs for Hens to Joe. Fortunately, that second raise does miss, and a great Shackle Shot locks down Exotic Deer, and might just get the pick off on our Bane as well. Chaos Knight brings his illusions into the middle lane, and Danish Bear's actually targeting that one, thinking, oh yeah, maybe he popped his ultimate and one of them's real, but that was actually just illusions.
Nisha had no mana for Grave. It's like a super sad situation where Dazzle's standing there like, I can nearly Grave you if my wand comes off cooldown and doesn't actually get it off. And poor Shadow Fiend just drops in front of him.
And now another tower falls. All the meanwhile, they're getting room to Ryze, who now has his level 6 as well. Familiar's ready to go
and a medallion.
The Medallion of Courage. And this just means when they start taking away these towers, they open up the possibility of Roshan as well. And that's something that ATN do not want to give up because their lineup is actually meant to do Roshan pretty well. Hero Supreme. Working towards the armlet now. So I like the drums. I think the Treads drums is still the right build, but I think I like the armlet after. Durka just lost one of his in-ear rubber things. You know, your headphones have those rubber things at the end. I hate those. I can't stand them because they always fall out. That's why I just get these. You know, it's always the headphones that are like $5 that actually are the most comfortable for me.
They hurt my ears. That's the only issue. Like, these annoy me because I always lose the shitty little rubber things that fall off. And, you know, it's not that they just fall off. They fall off and they ping somewhere. They just, like, go to the edges of the room somehow.
Oh, my God. Chocolate, you did not want to hit that hook shot. You are a lucky man that you missed that. I'm sure he still would have been fine, but that was risky as all hell.
You wanted in. Shadowfiend going straight into the SMY. He's got his Sands done. And this is something that we've seen, like, a diversion away a little bit from the mech build. A lot of NA teams have been going Midas first if you're pretty far ahead and you can flash farm the jungle, get Midas, then SMY helm. Then you basically play like a TA does. You stack and farm ancients, you just build yourself up and keep farming through. And you hit that peak where you're a right-click carry a lot faster. You don't have the same, like, brute force from a mech Shadow Fiend, you know, as you do 12 minutes in when you've got the mech, you push tier 1s. But you're still tanky, you're still a frontliner. And you also, you know, hit that mark a lot faster. Mm-hmm. During the pause, can I find it?
Well, it is 13 minutes in. Time to look at some metrics. 1,500 gold lead for Danish Bears. But experience is going the way of ATN.
The Bears.
The older team. What we need is Danish Bears versus Vega Squadron.
Why?
Bears versus shark. Which mammal is supreme?
I think we had lemon dogs against Danish bears the other night. Versus bear. And it's sort of like,
goes exactly the way you expect it to.
The bear kind of just the bear kind of just slaughters the dog.
Dire's top tower is under attack. You know there are bear hunting dogs?
Yes.
There's a breed of bear hunting dog.
They're like some kind of mastiff, aren't they?
Yeah, I think so. Dire's
top tower. What was that like for lions?
It's probably both. I mean, let's be real. If a dog is big enough to challenge a lion, it's big enough to challenge a bear. But lemon dogs are not those kind of dogs. At least not right now.
What kind of dogs are they, Cap?
Right now, I would say they're...
Don't say Chihuahua or something.
No,
please.
No, I would never say... That's just insulting. Come on now. I would say they're like... in the world of animals, they're a nice, like...
golden retriever.
A lab or something yeah. like that. You know, just a medium to large-sized dog, but it can't tussle with sharks and bears.
It's not a staffy, it's not a master.
In its own class, it's one of the better ones.
It's friendly. It's nice.
What other animal teams do we have? We need more animal teams, I think.
We've got two monkey teams.
Yeah. Their monkey is... Like, for example, Vega Squadron just have a shark. It's not part of their name or anything.
Okay.
Danish bears, like, at least... I don't know. It somehow works. Both the monkey teams are just, like, not really to do with monkeys.
It's just like,
I don't know what monkey freedom fighters have to do with anything, but... Apparently it's a Sing Sing thing, I don't know. And then monkey business, I mean, that's not about monkeys at all, let's be real.
Like, lol monkeys, what a meme. I don't know, are there any?
Like, you know, let's get some... Let's rename ATN to the... What's a Polish animal? Polish jaguars. I know jaguars aren't in Poland, believe me. I couldn't think of a Polish, so we'll just go jaguars. Like the Polish jaguars, you know?
Dire's top tower is under attack. Can you say the animal name again for me, please?
Jaguars. Jaguar.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, we pronounce it funny.
Yep, that's the only word. That's the only word you pronounce funny.
You say it.
No, it's fine. I'll just continue looking for my little rubber thing. I dropped my rubber, guys. See, in America, that's a naughty word. In England, it's just an eraser.
Yeah, in Germany... In Germany, they also call telephones handy.
Oh my god, please. No, not this again.
Come on, Germany.
I could not stop giggling. I could not stop giggling. I can't remember who... It was the tech guy. Or was it Jan? I can't remember. Someone asked me, do you want a company handy? And I was like, oh, Ace, I'm so sorry. You are Roger.
Yeah, you're dead, and so is Noya. ATN just barrel right on through them. Oh, Noya. He lives. Fly, Articuno, fly. Articuno, return.
There's no lightning, is there? No lightning legendary bird in Dota 2.
Zapdos.
Yeah. Because we have Moltres, is Phoenix. Articuno is Wyvern.
Oh, you're saying in Dota.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hero? He's gonna get saved by the Shell Graves. The power shot isn't really there.
Now
Shackle gets that kill. They're gonna look for a little bit more here. Noya's still trying to get in range of Winter's Curse. Asu just barely gets out. Winter's Curse on Nisha, which actually catches the Bane as well. They're gonna make sure they slow down Nisha as he's the easier kill. And Bane, he will be able to get out.
The Drow Ranger, though. Getting picked off before the fight even begins. Still, though, comes back alive, and the push is straight on for Danish Bears, barreling down middle lane.
I think Danish Bears have to start 5-manning together. They can't afford to... Once somebody's out of position, their whole lineup falls apart. But if they're 5-manning, they actually have a pretty decent shot. Sleep up on our Winter Wyvern, Exotic Deer.
They've got Grip again.
Fiend's Grip onto Ryze. He sends his familiars to stop that one. Actually stops Hero Supreme in the process. Ryze is still going to be slowed down enough that he will die. Eventually. And that should be the end of it.
A big issue here is that they don't have arcanes. Like, there's no mana sustain for any of these heroes apart from, like, Bothell on the Windranger. So they're running out of mana after one fight. And like you're saying, this team really does want to 5-man and push into towers, take objectives, and maybe find a head-on-head 5v5 at some point to get into these tier 3s or the last tier 2 remaining. But if they take a fight and expend, you know, 3/4 of their mana pool and then push into a tower, then they expend the last quarter spamming out like Splinter Blast and a Power Shot, they've got nothing left to give. Mm-hmm. So alternate, if they are on the back foot a little bit defending, they've got Fountain Regen, they've got Mana Regen, they've got Arcanes over on two heroes. So they've got tons to sustain them.
A stun on the side, Exotic Deer. Chucklet actually chooses not to go for the battery assault inside the cogs. I thought he could have actually... Oh, never mind. I forgot. The Aegis. So that's why he goes for the cogs pushback. Still, that was a nice disengage. I mean, at this point, anytime you can get into some sort of fight that doesn't involve the Draw Ranger and get out alive, I think you're going to be pretty happy, because then you're just creating space while waiting off the Aegis. This does mean they're going to lose their tower, though. Danish Bears, they'll probably spam, but I don't know if they really want to challenge.
They have Curse, but Ryze and Ace are so far away from this, there's no real point in jumping in. Top tower has fallen. Oh, Windranger.
Just ahead of the Fiend's Grip.
And the thing is, Alternate knows exactly where Ryze and Ace are with this Observe Ward over in the jungle. So they know that Drow Ranger and Visage, yeah, they're pinging out right here. They're both farming here. There's really no contest out from Danish Bears to control these lanes. And with Aegis gone, it's probably just going to be a little bit of passive play. Alternate shove the waves across the river a little bit, go back to the jungle, farm Ancients, and then group up to go and take... Like, maybe bot tier 2. I don't know if mid tier 2 is going to be the safest route for them because of things like Hook and Winter's Curse. So maybe a smoke. Oh, yeah, they've already smoked. Smoke down to bot tier 2 through the jungle, I think. So they've already got Sasu, like, heavily shoving this lane down. Unless they find someone mid. Which they do.
Green is going to catch Chocolate. It's a pretty decent pickup.
Jeez!
Yeah. Between the minus armor, double minus armor, and then a Shadow Wave.
Where did he go?
Clockwork is in heaven now. ATN take the 4v5 to the tier 2 in the middle lane.
Robo heaven with Bender.
At least they thought. They've got a medallion now for the Dazzle, so add a little bit of more minus armor to the list.
Like they needed it.
Exotic Deer almost has his BKB, so that's something.
He's super tanky as well.
When they have that, I think maybe they push in again. I'm not sure. Do you want to wait out the... Because I feel like you're just about to really hit your timing for Danish Bears. So you get a pick off on the Dazzle. Because I feel like this team, they're going to get bullied early, but once they hit like 25 minutes, they get super strong.
Yeah, it's like Drow level 11. Gets her first primary item and then, you know, builds into that sort of next middle stage item. I don't know if it's gonna be a blink here for the SMY Drow Ranger or if she goes into a BKB now. It's a really tough, like, it is honestly a really tough choice to actually decide what to build into.
Yeah, because a blink really wouldn't be bad at all. I actually would really like that against the Chaos Knight, but...
But then do you want to stand your ground and fight, or do you want to try and increase farming speed, split pushing, and catch potential? Because if the hook shot fails, They've got no plan B. They've got to land a hook shot, get the Winter's Curse onto multiple heroes, and then dogpile onto someone with the physical damage they have. Oh goodness, like this.
Sasu. Just ripped apart. You know how brave these creeps are. Hold up, bottom. Nisha gets off the Shallow Grave. These heroes have overextended themselves, but a great Shackle shot. They're still going to be able to get the Fiend's Grip, but a Cold Embrace actually keeping Ace alive, allowing the Windranger to output more damage until the SF steps in with the ultimate. Wipes out everyone else. A Blink Dagger away. Chocolate stays ahead of the Reality Rift. Noya, he is going to be caught, though. TP out, but just gets eliminated with the right click. And Chocolate actually used the hook shot to jump over to Hested Joe. Make sure they do get out. They force a lot of rotations, but lose three heroes in the process.
Yeah, and the big problem is, even if you have a BKB for the Drow Ranger, it's still not going to save you from the SF and the Chaos Knight just thwacking you to pieces. But then do you have time to go for a... Oh, geez. Clockwork. Oh, Supreme with stun. Finishes them off. There we go. Heavy hitting.
You know what's funny? If that was a 4-second stun, he probably would have lived.
And the reduced damage.
Yeah, and then he has the cogs. Oh, never mind. There was a Reality Rift.
But yeah, the blink is like a good stopgap item now to go for. Do you have time to actually build up into something bigger? Is my main question. Like 1600 gold, you're definitely saving for something. But what is that something? Can you afford to wait for Butterfly? Oh, are they getting a kill here?
They are. Zotadir just slowed down so much. I'm really going to side with the Blink Dagger now that I see like openings like that. I think you really have to take advantage of. Because Chaos Knight is such a burst-oriented hero that if you just, like, blink back defensively, you'll find an opening after that. And I think that the Blink Dagger would actually allow you to find a lot more catch.
Yeah.
Where once you broke ATN, then you're just going to clean up the rest of them. It's funny, I was listening to one of the Dan Carlin podcasts. Does this podcast on history and of war. And you're talking about how in like medieval times, just ancient war in general, like 90% of the people who died in a battle happens after the enemy breaks. Like during that period of time where the enemies just like clash against each other and then they back up and they clash and they back up and clash.
Nothing happens.
Very minimal casualties. But it's really, once one side breaks, that's where you just clean up everybody, where it just becomes a slaughter.
That's people turning their backs, running away, getting slammed by horses and shit like that.
Yeah. And that's how I kind of feel like Danish Bear. It's like, once they break the Chaos Knight or the SF, then all hell breaks loose and they just start running down the rest of ATN because their damage is so insane. But you just have to get through that first really tanky, like, frontline hero.
With the grave and the heal and the weave and everything behind him, yeah.
Supreme, he's just gonna run right forward. Shackle Shot does catch him. This is gonna be awkward, but he's still super tanky. And his sleep's actually gonna go out. Winter's Curse on the side. They turn their attention to Sasu, but a Shallow Grave will save him. Now they start chasing forward. Haven't gained a hero yet. And now, Hesta Joe's actually gonna be caught by the Fiendscape. Pull back in. Exotic Deer lets loose that ultimate, but he still gets away with the Wind Run. Rise drops the familiars beautifully. Cold Embrace helping to be able to buy Rise some time here. But ATN, they just survive through everything with their tank. Nice resummon of the familiars, and that will actually allow them to perhaps get a kill here. Supreme controlled up once again, but the Shallow Grave comes in for a secondary time in this fight. Silence goes out. Ace trying to go for Supreme as best he can, but he can't quite catch him. And now Exotic Deer is right in his face. Hesta Joe challenging Sasu. Can't win that one. It's the Void actually gets the kill. Chocolate backing the rest of ATN back up, but will be caught by the Reality Rift. And Ace is the only member of Danish Bears to survive in the end as the Chaos Knight. When did he die to? What? He died to a creep.
I don't know. I guess he armlet toggled off. Where did he die?
You want to look at that combat lag? Because that was...
Targets.
That was interesting.
Chaos.
He got caught in some sort of armlet toggle scenario. I figured it was like familiars or something, but...
This was a mistake.
Is a combat log break Dota?
Looks like it.
Oh.
Of course it does.
Yeah, that bug certainly hasn't been discovered.
Oh, wait. I have just been disconnected from the server. Great, thanks.
Was it the moment you clicked the button? All right.
Yeah.
I'll pass that on to Bruno.
Combat log, please. I'll try again. All right, it worked this time. Killed by ranged creep. Yeah, he turned off armlet, got hit for 17 damage and got killed. And then I've crashed again.
That's sad, Chaos Nightlife. But yeah, we were talking about, like, you have to break one of those heroes. Well, what happened? Like, they went in and they almost broke so many of these heroes and it never, like, they just couldn't finish one of them off. Armlet toggling, Shallow Grave saves, even the defensive Nightmare was there. Supreme, Ace actually backed up a little bit. They may still be able to get the kill. There's the additional little pushback from the Silence, but
no,
they can't go for it. The Power Shot, Winter's Curse onto Exotic Deer, but doesn't catch the Chaos Knight. And the rest of the team, not really on the same page. I feel like if the Drow Ranger had continued forward earlier, they would have been able to commit for the Chaos Knight. And then even that Winter's Curse, like, again, just not on the same page as your two damage dealers. Which is a little bit interesting because I usually feel like this team does very well in their early team fights and they have really good communication. But here, everything just seems to be a bit off.
And now there's Sasu with the Ags upgrade on the Night Stalker. He sees everything. No gem yet. So that's going to be coming soon. Saving up for it, I'm guessing. Yeah, the thing is with that fight up by the tier 2 top, bot lane even, They had double Nightmare Save, like you said, double Grave. The fight just lasted that little bit too long. If they'd found the finishing blow on the Chaos Knight 5 or 6 seconds earlier, and they just committed for that one hero, then maybe they can come out on top and they do find that break. And then they move on to the Dazzle or the Shadow Fiend, someone like that. The trouble is, I feel they've got to try and focus down the supports beforehand. You know, hook onto the Dazzle, find that pick off before going for the core.
Ooh, that Blink Dagger.
Tight.
Barely saves Hester Joe's life. They will see Rei's TPing away. And Supreme is in an awkward position. Someone pull him a creep. Now Mr. Melee Creep stuck. Swapped places.
Oh, now he's not stuck anymore. Now he's dead. There is a buckler on the Night Stalker. Against physical damage and negative armor in particular, Crimson Guard is pretty good.
It is. I love it against Windranger, but is it too late in the game for something like a Crimson Guard?
I don't think so. Like, there's not a massive amount of damage coming out of these heroes. Like, especially with the positive armor buff you're getting from the Dazzle as well, everything adds up. And yeah, the Drought Ranger is going for Butterfly, right? So definitely deciding for that big ticket item rather than one of the smaller ones. Completes it. No buyback. Is this going to be an all-in from them to try and win a team fight now?
Maybe. ATN do back up as their ultimate was fading away, the Phantasm. It's one of the big downsides of the Chaos Knight. You almost have to fight around Phantasm once you start getting past 30 minutes. And it has such a long cooldown. Fortunately, much longer duration than before, so you can really use it to siege down towers pretty well.
And smoke time. Clear bot wave, smoke. But where do you head? Where do you go from here?
I think ATN are still pretty happy with just sitting back and farming. Like, I think at a certain point you start to have to lessen your hold on the game a bit.
Well, so you don't give too much away if you lose a team fight?
Yeah, I think if you start playing a little bit too aggressively right now into Danish Bears, the butterfly upgrade just came in. I think you need to start playing perhaps a bit more defensively almost. At the very least, don't push high ground. Like, I think they just should just stall out this game for a bit.
Yeah, there's two tier 2s still standing, and you're still pretty worried about Winter's Curse, that one big ability that can really put a stop to your push. Yeah. And with the Drow Ranger, you pretty much know that they want to split push and take down this tier 2 bot lane to try and secure at least some control over the rush pit a little bit later on. Mm-hmm. Yeah, everyone's pinging it out, both Dire and Radiant, saying we need to take this tower and we also need to defend this tower. It's pretty low on the HP, actually.
One of the big reasons that I want them to play defensively in that I want them to play around nighttime, and they don't have the gem yet on the Night Stalker, and they don't have like the Crimson Guard or whatever they're going to be building for him either. They need to play around the vision game right now. They can't just like 5-man into Danish Bears and expect to continue to win these fights. Yes, they're tanky as all hell, but the damage upgrade that just came in for Danish Bears is quite significant. Like, the butterfly means a huge damage upgrade for the Drone Ranger in and of itself, yes, but then you couple that with the precision aura on her and everyone else, most notably the Wind Ranger, as well as the familiars. Like, that's a gigantic boost of damage across the board for almost every single member of Danish Bears. So you really got to be careful fighting around that one. So I would say sit back, farm up the rest of your items. Looks like BKB for the Chaos Knight. SF is going to build into something with the 4K gold. We'll see what it is. I honestly wouldn't mind something like straight Scotty or an MKB. MKB would be an obvious choice to counter Windranger and Drone Ranger, so I like it a lot.
I feel the Chaos Knight offers them that frontline like tanky hero, which Shadow Fiend usually fills, but yeah. Shadow Fiend did that for the first 15 minutes, and now Chaos Knight's kind of filling that spot. But I like the Skadi as well. It's great against Visit Familiars, the Drow Ranger in general, slowing, kiting, and keeping her in place. But they do need something to deal with the evasion.
Is it just smoke up? Sasu is chasing down Ace right now. They see the turnaround. The Winter's Curse is laid out on the Bane, but that's not really much. Sasu's taking a lot of damage. Great Shackle Shot. TP out from Sasu. He gets away with just 200 HP. Meanwhile, the two carries. Exotic Deer's just being torn apart by Ace right now. Finally, the Chaos Knight gets on Ace, but a Winter's Cold Embrace actually saves Ace for the time being. And Supreme realizes he needs to commit to that one, but the Glimmer Cape actually saves Ace. And Supreme now has to go for other kills. So that would have been a decent fight for ATN, but their SF got comboed down so quickly because of that great Clockwork Cogs. And then Supreme being unable to finish off the Draw Ranger is a huge blow to them.
Nice Stalker forced out. The double shackle on the defensive supports, you know, forcing the Grave, forcing pretty much all of your defensive abilities onto the supports themselves. That's the ideal fight for them. Mm-hmm. That's what Danish Bears have been looking for. Find those defensive supports, make sure that the carries, the Shadow Fiend in particular, can't get graved up, and there's no annoying nightmare being thrown onto, you know, your Drow Ranger or your Wind Ranger. And then they just pick people off from there. You've got to say, the double cogs onto the carries, though, the SF and Chaos Knight both trapped in there. They've got to be fortunate that the BKB actually arrived for the Chaos Knight, or else he might have just died as well in the duration of the cogs, but
yeah.
Kind of fortunate he managed to turn it around with the BKB and get another couple of kills. But how long ago did Aegis expire? They didn't, because Shadowfiend still had that a couple of minutes ago.
I'm not sure.
I don't see the timer anymore.
You don't? It's been a minute? Minute and a half?
So it must have been relatively close to the start of the fight.
I have a hard time reading it, because I forgot. Is it the very bottom tick that is when Aegis expires? It's that one, right?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
So it's been like 2 or 3
Aegis gets taken there.
Oh, it's that one?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So 1, 2, 3, 3.5.
Okay. So maybe it expired a little bit before.
Smoke up. They're going to find Noya's a really good entry frag. If they can get Noya down and then move on for the rest, but it doesn't look like they're going to catch him in time. Ace as well, Shocklet will get out.
Incoming.
I was just about to say a butterfly after watching that last display of the Draw Ranger. Like, I wanted the Scotty because I thought tanking up, I wasn't sure if, like, going the damage build would benefit you if you start becoming the target of somebody. And I much prefer the butterfly now that I see, just because the Draw Ranger is obviously not going to have MKB for a while. The Wind Ranger is likely to build one soon. Like, especially now that he sees that Talisman Innovation might forgo the Daedalus in exchange for the faster MKB. But you're still, like, limiting her on item slots and such.
Yeah. And you can pull my favorite move in the game. The bait the butterfly, then switch to damage item.
Oh, yeah.
Because Talisman of Evasion is such a great, like, cost-efficient item with the evasion it gives you. Then forcing people to buy MKB to try and deal with it makes it even more cost-effective, because, you know, you've bought this 1,800 gold worth item, faking out the butterfly or saying, hey, look, I'm going to go for a butterfly. And then they spend, you know, 6,000 gold or whatever on the Monkey King bar. But I'm pretty certain he's going to buy the full butterfly. There's no real reason not to.
Guard blocks 55 damage. The Drone Ranger is currently hitting for 370 some.
Yeah, when I saw the Crimson Guard being built, I thought it was good. At this stage, after a couple of good fights from Danish Bears and the item progression they've got, negligible. Right. It's still going to do something, but not a lot of something.
It's still really good. Like, the biggest thing, Crimson Guard is super good versus Wind Ranger, because she usually holds low damage but really high attack speed. Even our Wind Ranger is a decent amount of damage. Almost 200 damage a shot, plus the Crystallis.
Well, they've both got BKBs now as well. So the Crimson Guard out of that Dazzle no longer really screws them over, which it was doing in previous fights. So that's another thing to look out for, now that you can't Crimson through Magic Community. But Roshan goes to Dire. Is it Aegis and Cheese? Aegis and Cheese.
take that.
Running down ATN. They just going for a five-man push bottom. The lanes are decently pushed out, like middle's in a great position. Top is far enough away from the top lane that it won't actually, there's not a real threat of split push. So ATN are probably just gonna all in here.
Well, the high ground defense from Danish Bears is one spell. It's Winter's Curse. And if they've got these multiple lives on heroes where potentially they can dive in, maybe catch the Winter Wyvern off guard, I think Rax, they're going to glyph this to try and defend a little bit, but Rax will fall here, and I don't know if Danish Bears force a fight. Like, Ace doesn't have a TP. They're just going to let Rax fall. There's no way. There's no way they can test this. Fully, anyway.
And good read by Supreme, I think, holding on to his ultimate. Because now, if they wanted to, they could back up and still go for another push.
Oh, man. If Ace had a TP while he was pushing that lane, he could have taken tier 3 at top. Or at the very least, forced a glyph to get some kind of trade off.
Yeah, forced TPs. Dire's top tower is under attack.
Now, do we just go down middle lane again? ATN, not giving up. Oh, we've got one TP back at least, the Bane.
Yeah, he was hoping to get the sneaky pick off on Draw Ranger, at least stopping TPs, but.
But now the fight to jump in.
Oh, Shackle Shot, Supreme immediately going to be the target here. Mass Armor, though, coming out on him. He's going to be controlled by the Familiars and Glimmer Cape save. Exotic Deer, the next target, but BKB popped. Now the ultimate goes down from Supreme, but it's a bit too late until he turns around and wipes out the Wind Ranger. Ultimate goes down from the SF. Supreme is going to be saved by the Shallow Grave, and he still has a cheese. He'll eat it and pursue. Silence to actually be able to buy Ace some time with a Force Staff along the side, but they still have the Phantasm Illusions to push forward now onto that Tier 3 tower.
And they can jump on Ace, right? There's no BKB. Yeah. So Drow has to be incredibly careful with the positioning here. That's a little bit far forward. That's too far forward.
Yeah.
That's death.
Be caught by the Reality Rift. 3 seconds stun. Exotic Deer. Oh, wow.
Good visage familiar.
He didn't actually rotate his attention right away. Fiend's Grip on a Shocklet. They pull Ace into the cogs as well. What a combo there. Supreme finds the opening on the enemy cogs. And this will be a second lane of Rax, it looks like, as the Drow Ranger is just not going to get here in time, even as she does. He's just going to be pursuing for a kill that may not even happen. Hero Supreme tries to challenge. Nope, he gets caught and will be kited around until the end of the Shallow Grave.
Armlet toggling.
Go for the kill. Critical. If he gets it, armlet toggle a little bit more. He's just not getting any of these right clicks out. New comes in, still
they
not
can't
enough.
Kill him.
Jesus, he's
got
surviving
he's got BKB.
All these. The familiars, though. As well as the nuke from Ryze, finally ensure the kill.
Two lanes are axed, though. As a Drow Ranger lineup, when, you know, this is the end of your peak, right? 40 yeah. minutes.
It's really awkward for you to come back.
Let's see, where do they go? Chocolate? He's nearly got his Aghanim Scepter. But the fact that Shadow Fiend has 6,000 gold saved up on top of all the items he has. It's pretty disgusting.
Yeah.
And even the Chaos Knight, 4,500. He doesn't really have any, you know, big discernible items. BKB Armlet, Halberd Drums, Treads, there's no heart, no Manta style or anything like that. Nothing that's oh god scary kind of thing. Invisibility.
Is Danish Bears going for an aggressive play here?
Yeah.
I think they just... The problem is going to be Sasu isn't enough. Right? Like, this isn't going to stop that much. They're so desperate to catch something here. They're not even going to get Sasu. Shackle Shot latches, and Bane will be that kill. Nisha? A little bit far forward as well, but they dive in too deep for this. Oh, just before the Shallow Grave
goes
off.
There's no buybacks on their support.
Danish Bears?
Oh, what? He must have just got buyback.
Tick gold it is. You know what's the most aggravating thing is when you have, oh, sleep. Has to Joe, Fiend's Gripped, and they don't have any sort of initiation to counter this one. Just the Cold Embrace to buy Hester Joe time, but Exotic Deer's like, okay, go ahead and do that. I'll just line up that ultimate, and they're gonna pick off three.
Now that's the Jaffa trying to go for the play mid. And it looked like, honestly, it was going to work. They got the two supports. They didn't have buyback until that Bane comes back. Super surprised that they actually just managed to get it with the tick gold. And now it might even be game with Team Alternate in a situation where they can start to look just to run down mid lane and look for the tier 4s.
Yeah, when you have both the Butterfly and the MKB, and the Windranger is still not looking for that next item at all, and the Draw Rangers are not going to have an MKB either, the SF just went from, like, countering your physical damage to now countering your dodge as well, your evasion, on both the Draw Ranger and Windranger.
Backdoor regen?
He's a beast.
Who needs backdoor regen?
Exotic deer.
What are they doing?
Are they gonna go tier fours? Like this kind of clowny stuff is what happens when teams try and throw the game. Fortunately, they curbed their enthusiasm a little bit.
Hey.
What? Radiant's top tower. What are they doing? Roshan is nowhere close to being up.
I am unsure.
Why didn't they take out the tier two? What is the only thing stopping them right now?
They could have stayed top and waited for the creep wave.
I don't know. That's really weird. Why wouldn't you take out the tier two at the base? Like, if you don't want to five man into the base, that's fine. But all right, that play literally made no sense. It's like they just got lost all of a sudden.
Where are we? Help!
Some early stage dementia happening.
Where am I?
So is it all in moment version 2 for Danish Bears? Do they have a smoke?
I guess.
Are they smoking? When Dwyvern has a smoke? Time to go and hide yourselves.
I don't know. Hero Supreme, he's got illusions. Chaos Knight is one of those heroes. Like him, Phantom Lancer, Medusa. Those are like the illusions become your double damage, essentially.
Illusions act as another bloody hero.
Alright, now time to go for the tier 2, but the wave's already pushed back up, so you gotta have to go catch it.
Clock has Ags, but will he be able to use two hookshots in a team fight?
If he hookshots and immediately force staffs out, yes. If he doesn't do that and he tries to do, like, anything else, any sort of battery assault and then force staff out, like, once he feels in danger, I'm pretty sure he's just gonna get blown up.
A 3 hit by the SF?
Yeah.
Maybe not 3 hit, but... Shadow Fiend does a lot of damage. Slow and steady.
I mean, if there's enough minus armor.
Yeah, it's possible.
The end of Weave, where you're at like minus 30 armor or something absurd.
With Crimson. And Presence of the Dark Lord and the Chaos Knight crit hit.
You keep saying Crimson, but you mean Solar Crest.
Have I been saying Crimson Guard? I've just got this Crimson Guard from the Nightstalker stuck in my head.
Yeah.
Solar Crest. That's what I think I'm saying.
The first time I pieced it together, I was just like, by the time I got it, I was just like,
whatever, it's passed.
I was like, oh, it's too late.
The Crimson Crest.
Boy, they're really okay. They are ensuring their victory. They're going for the next Roshan. Like 99% sure about that. There's no way you wait this long to push.
Rocket flare.
I mean, they don't even have like any really big significant items coming in. Their cores are in a good spot, but they're not ready for that next item. Sasu, as the offlane Night Stalker, he's getting close to AC. That's the closest thing, but I'm pretty sure that doesn't mean as much.
Oh, they're all dead.
As Joe gets off the BKB and Winter's Curse turnaround with a Shackle Shot over the top. No, they get off their BKB in return, and now it's time for Hero Supreme just to reign supreme over all over Danish Bears. They've lost their Draw Ranger. Winter Wyvern dies in a flood of illusions. And that's a minute and a half on the clock for a Draw Ranger and a full minute for Danish Bears. That's all. Oh, never mind. He just got buyback. Or is the gold thing
bugged? I'm wondering if it's bugged now. Because
yeah,
that's twice where I've seen no buyback available on the top bar.
Well, Windranger, he buys back as well. They're running low on numbers, though. There's only so many more buybacks they can afford to go. Ace trying to challenge, but he's going to go down to just these two supports in the offlaner. Exotic Deer makes it look easy, though. Now, almost three-shotting the clockwork. Look at that. Jesus. There it is. Finally, GG. It's Chaos Knight. What a hero. It did a lot of work.
The minus arm strat is real.
Yeah.
No visage, no drow. Nothing like that for them.
I would say that that team ATN got, I would say, maybe a farther ahead early than they should have. Like, there was never that point, remember, I was like 25 minutes, right? There was never really that point in time where I felt Danish Bears just kind of like...
We never saw anything from Clockwork this game. Like, he never got that period of the game where it's like, okay, hookshot, kill, hookshot, kill. There was never sort of any pickoff moment. Team Alternate was grouped up too quickly. Like, the middle lane ensured Shadowfiend got a quick, you know, treads, wand, bottle, sand, got himself tanky on the front lines. Chaos Knight got free farm top lane, Nightstalker, you know, just did his thing. And then they ran around the map with the two supports they had. They could set up, they could react, they could turn things around quite easily, and there was nothing the Danish Bears could do to react, really.
Yeah, I think ATN were just kind of ahead of the ball. On all fronts, so... Well played by Team ATN. They take this game number one. We'll be back with game number two after a short break.